I went to the chamber to watch the debate over the Electoral College. We were in the midst of the objection to Arizona, and suddenly texts started coming in that the Capitol had been breached. Eventually, we saw a lot of commotion. The vice president, the speaker, and the majority leader were escorted out of the chamber. We had to stop our deliberations. Then we were told that the insurrectionists had breached the rotunda and were heading towards the chamber. They had eventually breached the Senate chamber, the speaker's office, and almost breached the House chamber. I could hear banging on the doors of the House chamber, and I thought at first it was Capitol Police communicating with each other, but it was in fact these domestic terrorists who were trying to interrupt our transfer of power. We were eventually asked to pull out our gas masks. We heard a pop, 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 pop sound, and it was flashbang equipment to disperse these insurrectionists, as well as tear gas. We were rushed across the gallery to the other side of it. Many of the members who were with us are older, and it was a horrifying scene, particularly for them, those with physical disabilities or impairments. We had to get down for several minutes as there was confusion about whether the chamber was going to be breached. Eventually, we were able to have the Capitol Police secure one way out of the chamber and down the stairs to the basement to get us to a secure location. When we were walking through, they had already had on the ground several of these domestic terrorists who looked at us like they wanted to take us out. And after a few hours, the Capitol was secured. We continued our duties. We were resolved to finish the Electoral College count, and did so by the wee hours of 4 a.m. The Senate did the same, and we have now certified Joe Biden as the next president of the United States.
So did you feel personally at risk, in danger during that experience?
Without question. When I started hearing what I thought might have been gunshots, turns out they were flashbang disbursement devices and tear gas, we were told to get down and that we risk being shot. I saw officers in the chamber with guns drawn and hearing banging on the doors, the smashing of glass to get in the chamber. By then I had been made aware that the Senate chamber had been breached, and they came within feet of us and behind the doors. And thank God for the heroism of the Capitol Police to help save us. This was the first armed insurrection of the Capitol in over 200 years since the War of 1812. There are many questions that will have to be asked about the events of yesterday, and there will be many investigations that will have to happen and many reforms as a result. We cannot let the Capitol ever again be this insecure. Think about not only our democracy, but what our foreign adversaries could be thinking about this situation. But rest assured, with the incoming unified Democratic government, we have the will, along with many Republicans who voted to reject the objections last night, a working government to resolve these issues, in addition to the biggest priority, which is to be able to defeat the coronavirus and bring our country back to prosperity.
How did this happen, given that many people assume Washington, D.C. is one of the most secure cities in the nation? And there's also been contrasts drawn with the law enforcement response to the Black Lives Matter protests over the summer. How do you square that circle?
There's nothing to square about it. It's wholly differential treatment. First, President Trump incited a violent mob to descend upon the Capitol, invade, which they did, refused in the beginning to allow the National Guard to attend. He put his own vice president at risk, who had to overrule that decision, and we got the National Guard involved. There were potential breaches of both the building, but also potentially members or staff that could have been involved, or others. These are questions that we will answer. But certainly, we saw a very different story this summer when Black Lives Matter protesters protested their rights, when Dreamers come to the Capitol, when folks who are protesting the Muslim ban came to the Capitol. We saw heavy-handed tactics and suppression tactics that were beyond the pale with these protesters. And now they choose to do a light touch and allow armed folks invading the Capitol to come through nearly unmolested in some cases. It's incredible that there weren't shots fired to defend the House and Senate chambers when you have armed folks running to the door to stop the transfer of power. It's incredible that there weren't enough resources given, but we have an incoming new president in Biden who understands the deep gravity of what's happened yesterday. And we are resolved to secure the Capitol and our democracy for the future.
We still have a period of time to go before that administration is sworn in. And I wonder what you think should happen now. Are you joining with the leaders of your party in Congress in calling for the 25th Amendment to be invoked?
President Trump, through his inciting of an insurrection of the Capitol, is a clear and present danger to our democracy. I wholly support his removal by the 25th Amendment or by impeachment. He cannot serve another 2 weeks. Now, we know these are the tools that we have. They aren't swift. There's a possibility he may be able to hang on for these next 2 weeks, but our military, our institutions have to realize just what happened yesterday. The President of the United States incited an insurrection against the Congress to stop the peaceful transfer of power. This is a day yesterday that will live in infamy, much like Pearl Harbor. And people will think, how could this happen? This is something that is relegated to the history books, armed insurrections at the Capitol. But this happened on January 6, 2021. And we will do everything we can to pursue the reforms to secure our Capitol and our democracy. And we have a working government to do it. 94 Democrats and Republicans in the Senate rejected these frivolous objections to undermine our democracy. And many Republicans joined the House Democratic majority in rejecting these frivolous objections. That is a workable government to go into the new unified Democratic government to address these reforms, in addition to the biggest reason we were elected, which is to defeat the coronavirus, bring our nation back to prosperity, address climate change and justice issues in this nation.
Just finally, quick question, if I may, on coronavirus. Obviously, Florida is continuing to see heavy caseloads. There's been criticism of the rollout in the state of the vaccines. How do you see the rollout, and what would you encourage from the DeSantis administration?
The rollout has been a mixed bag, obviously. We see on the federal level, there's inconsistencies in the guidance under the Trump administration. We see on the state level, leaving it to each county to have their own system. We see Orange County be more of a model where you can register online and you go when your time is called. And then we see other areas, first come, first serve, having our seniors wait online all through the night. These are already vulnerable folks, bringing them out in a pandemic with the uncertainty of whether they're going to get a vaccine or not. That is a disgrace. When we swear in Joe Biden as our next president, one, we will utilize the Defense Production Act to the fullest extent of the law and utilize every pharmaceutical manufacturing facility in this nation that is capable to produce this life-saving set of vaccines. Two, we will have strong guidelines with enforceability to have a uniform effort. We will also utilize potentially the National Guard and other federal assets to deploy these vaccines as soon as possible. This needs to be on a scale and a swiftness as we saw with the response of World War II. And all we're seeing is sputtering and inconsistencies right now. And people are dying. We can't get through the next 2 weeks soon enough.